In this video lecture, we are going to be focusing on the regulation of mean arterial pressure, specifically the long-term regulation. So just to quickly recap, long-term regulation takes minutes to days to go into effect. It involves the kidneys, which then the kidneys can regulate your blood volume. By regulating blood volume, you can regulate the mean arterial pressure. So let's see how this is done. On this diagram, what we're going to be studying is the renin-angiotensin system and how the renin-angiotensin system controls arterial pressure. Remember that this is a long-term regulation. And we are going to be beginning with a situation where you have a decreased MAP. So MAP is low. Now there's several different pathways occurring in this diagram, and so be real careful as we go through this what specific pathway we're talking about. So I'm going to take you through the shortest pathway first. So when the mean arterial pressure is lowered, that gets detected by the kidneys. And when the kidneys detect this low mean arterial pressure, they produce less filtrate. So what this means is that you urinate less. So if we urinate less, then that's going to increase the blood volume. And by increasing the blood volume, that will increase MAP. Because remember, that needs to be the goal. If we start with a low MAP, the goal needs to be to return MAP back to normal by elevating it to the normal level. Now that's just one pathway. Now let's go ahead and follow another pathway here. So while that is happening, you also have baroreceptors that are detecting the low MAP. And so my question for you is, when MAP is low, what exactly are the baroreceptors detecting and what is their response? So would there be a lot of stretch in the detected by the baroreceptors or a little stretch detected by the baroreceptors? The correct answer is that there would be little stretch compared to normal. That gets detected by the baroreceptors. Because there's less stretch detected by the baroreceptors, they're going to send a low frequency of action potentials, right? They're going to develop a low frequency of action potentials, which is going to wind up causing a sympathetic response. So once we have the sympathetic response, what happens now is the sympathetic response will target the kidneys. The kidneys then will synthesize and secrete renin. Renin is an enzyme. This enzyme then catalyzes a whole bunch of reactions that we'll talk more about later. In fact, this is in the urinary system. And so ultimately what happens through these series of enzyme catalyzed reaction is the formation of a hormone called angiotensin II. So this hormone then, angiotensin II, targets the adrenal cortex, specifically the zona glomerulosa. And when it targets the zona glomerulosa, that's going to cause the synthesis and secretion of aldosterone. So remember the function of aldosterone. It increases sodium reabsorption. So if we reabsorb sodium, water follows. So that's going to increase water reabsorption by the kidneys as well. By increasing sodium reabsorption and therefore increasing water reabsorption, the blood volume goes up, which then increases the arterial pressure. Okay, now angiotensin II will also target the posterior pituitary. And when it targets the posterior pituitary, that's going to cause the release of ADH, antidiuretic hormone. Remember that antidiuretic hormone is also called vasopressin. So antidiuretic. It's not a diuretic, it does the opposite. So you're going to urinate less. We urinate less. And the reason we're urinating less is because of increased water reabsorption. Therefore, once again, if you increase water reabsorption, your blood volume goes up, and your MAP will go up as well. Now there's also a couple of intrinsic controls here as well. And so I'm going to put these intrinsic controls in blue for you because angiotensin II also causes vasoconstriction, this is an intrinsic control, of the blood vessels. So if they vasoconstrict, that's going to increase resistance. And when we increase resistance, the arterial pressure goes up as well. Now, what's not shown on this diagram is that ADH, it can also be intrinsically controlled, and that can cause vasoconstriction as well. So both angiotensin 2 and ADH can both cause vasoconstriction, which increase resistance and increase MAP. So this is the long-term mechanism using the kidneys to regulate your mean arterial pressure. So let's take an example. How does all of this work? Let's put it all together. So what I would like for you to do is pause the video, and then I would like you to use up or down arrows to indicate whether or not you think the level for each of these would go up or go down based on a patient that is hemorrhaged. So if you've had a patient that hemorrhaged, this means that they lose a lot of blood, huge amounts of blood. So pause the video, fill this out, and when you're ready, replay the video to see if your responses are correct. Okay, so I'm going to assume that you've already paused the video and you've already put your answers in. So let's go through this. If you hemorrhage, your blood volume is going to go down. You've lost a large component of your blood volume, which can cause, if there's less blood volume, your central venous pressure is going to go down. When that pressure goes down, there's less venous return, which is going to cause your end diastolic volume to go down, which causes your cardiac output to go down as well. Now, if cardiac output goes down, how do you think this will affect your end systolic volume? Well, if you're ejecting less blood, your end systolic volume should be high. All right, so if cardiac output goes down, we know based off of the formula then that MAP is also gonna go down. And so now the kidneys need to respond. So the kidneys respond by producing less urine, right? So we're going to be conserving water, conserving salts, which will then increase your blood volume. If you increase your blood volume, that will increase your central venous pressure. If there's higher pressure, that means you get more blood returning to the heart, so the venous return goes up. The more blood that comes into the heart, the larger your end diastolic volume, okay, which causes your cardiac output to go up. If cardiac output goes up, your stroke volume is going to go down, right? The larger ejection means there's less left in the heart, so ESV would go down. And finally, if cardiac output goes up, MAP is returned to normal. So remember that MAP fell drastically because you hemorrhaged, and now that MAP is elevated. And so the system will shut off via negative feedback. Now you could also come over this direction in your flow chart, and I would suggest adding the sympathetic response as well that you would have according to the image prior to this one. So here are a summary of the factors that actually increase MAP. And this is a nice little summary for you. It also includes your chemoreceptors. Remember, we talked about those with reference to respiration. And so this is not an all-inclusive summary. It just gives you an idea. It's a good way for you to start putting together all the factors that increase MAP, but there certainly are some things you can add to this to make it more complete. This will conclude the video on long-term regulation of mean arterial pressure.